I learned karate because my brother learned karate. I learned horse riding because my brother learned horse riding. But he learned kathak because I learned kathak. He learned piano because I learned piano. So there was really no difference. So I was not made the boy. We both were treated equally. We both had permission to go out at night, but we both had deadlines. So there was really no differentiating between the boy and the girl in the house. And so, you know, I never looked at it as a disadvantage. I never went out in the world as a girl or a woman or a, you know, a Muslim or a small town Hyderabadi. I just went out in the world. And every time there was a problem, I was like, okay, so how do we counter it? If I couldn't counter it, it was another path. So, you know, my life has been path of least resistance, you know. Try, circumvent, avoid, engage, try and turn them to your side or find someone else. So that's the two questions.
Perfect. This would be a perfect time to acknowledge Mrs. Hiptola Ilahi's mother. And please, if you would stand up for a minute, we'd really like to acknowledge your presence here and your upbringing.
You might want to help. Thank you, Ma.
So now let's begin at the beginning. We're talking Bollywood movies, and it always has a title. And yours is Ilahi. So that's a very unusual and very enchanting name. Can you tell us what it means?
Yes, Ilahi is a Persian name that means God's gift. Well, at least my parents thought so. So I was named Ilahi. And, you know, I have this accent on my name, and I swear that is in my birth certificate. It wasn't because I went to Alliance Francaise and I thought I could spell my name cooler. So, you know, my father took care of it right in the beginning because if it's spelled it E-L-A-H-E or I or whatever, it very easily gets, even today, pronounced as Ilahi, which actually is God. So I would like to think, but unfortunately I'm not God. So I'm Ilahi, which is God's gift, and that's what my name means.
And all movies start with a flashback, so we should have a flashback question. In your growing years, who were the women who inspired you and influenced you?
I mean, I would like to say my mother because she's here and I have to go home to her. So yes, Mama, you really inspired me. But, you know, this actually may sound... So when I was growing up, I think at a young age, about I think I was 13 or something, I read this really terrible book called Rage of Angels by Sidney Sheldon. But the protagonist in the book was this lady called Jennifer Parker, and she was a lawyer in the book. And that's it. She just completely overtook every bit of imagination that I had. And I wanted to be a lawyer ever since. I just wanted to be Jennifer Parker. And in fact, recently when I was cleaning out the library at home, I found books that were given to me as a gift saying, to our Jennifer Parker. And it's embarrassing now, but my tastes were not really developed in reading, you know. So Sidney Sheldon was a good read. And that's what I did. So I was a focused, I knew exactly what I was doing. When everybody went for their TOEFLs and the GREs and the GMATs, I was applying to law schools. And yes, I qualified as a lawyer. And that's the only thing I did not do. I just finished my law degree, and that's in my home, at home. But I did not pursue it as a career. But I'm a qualified lawyer because of Jennifer Parker. And another lady who I really, I swear, as kids, we would wake up early in the morning on Jan 26 to watch TV. And when Indira Gandhi said, Jai Hind, I still get goosebumps. I don't think there was ever any leader who said Jai Hind the way Mrs. Gandhi said. You know, for a moment, leave aside everything that she did or didn't do. But that Jai Hind reverberates with me. I mean, really, I mean, I get emotional when I think about it. But she truly inspired me. I mean, what is there not to be inspired by Indira Gandhi, right? As a growing person, when you were not so clear on your politics, or were not, you know, taking sides. She was a magnificent woman, and at least what we saw on TV and read in our Congress-wide notebooks. And so I genuinely admired Mrs. Gandhi.
It's a wide range, Jennifer Parker and Indira Gandhi.
So yeah, from Sheldon to Mrs. Gandhi.
Next question is, what is the big shift you'd like to see in the women of today?
What is the big shift I'd like to see in the women of today? That's a bit, I mean, who am I to say anything? But if I can get over that hurdle, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to give gyan. I don't think I have reached that place in time and life to be able to tell people what to do. and I'm still working to reach where I have to reach. But, you know, I think earlier in the day, Rekha said it, that it's all there, we just need to go get it. And I would really like people to be aware, you know, it's all there. We just need to be aware and we need to know what we're talking about. There's a lot being talked in cinema about how, you know, we are just not aware. These days, now to even much more, is if you have, if you look at cinema, you're just looking at those 3 hours of mindless entertainment when they come and say, leave your brains behind at home. And I never understand why I should leave a vital organ behind. Nobody tells me, come for dinner, but leave your kidneys behind. You know, come for chai, but please don't bring your heart, bhai. Arey, I am a whole person and I will go to every event with all my organs intact, so I'm not willing to leave my brains behind. But other than that, chalo, forget, I'm understanding the fact that we have escapist cinema and you want to be entertained and you want to leave your problems at home. I'm okay with all of that, right? As long as you're aware. You know, from time immemorial, and we've had these discussions in smaller groups and on larger platforms, where the depiction of how you're supposed to fall in love in Hindi cinema, it's appalling. You know, there was this film called Major Saab. I don't know how many of you watched it. It was a while back. And Ajay Devgan falls in love with Sonali Bendre. She at the time didn't know she was in love with him. But he could not take that because love equals obsession, right? So he followed her publicly on streets, pulled her dupatta, whistled, sang songs. All the while she was really not still convinced. So he was in the army. So he knew some inner ducts that came through sanitary pipes in the house, and he entered her bedroom and he kissed her. At that point, I thought it was going to be appalled. No, the next step is she fell in love with him. You're like, really? I mean, really? And then we crib about rapes and people stalking us. And really? So that was it. So chalo, wo zamana gaya, now we are more, you know, empowered and stuff like that. And then recently I see a film called Tanu Vets Manu Returns. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. And the vulgar answer you get is 130 crores. Okay, bhai, hoinga. Aapki daulat mereko nahi de rahe. So why am I, should I appreciate your really regressive, terrible politics? You know, in that film, the two Kanganas who were outstanding as actresses and their act, the entire world's sympathy of whoever watched that film, it was a film about this man who has a wife, but she's liberated, therefore she's crack. So he falls in, and she wants to leave him, so he falls in love with another woman who just looks like her. And that was his great shift. And that woman's a real sweet student who's doing long jumps, minding her own business, but he falls in love with her and he stalks her. And then he convinces her to marry him. And she, thrice in the movie I counted, she asks him, Sharma ji, aap mujhe chhodoge nahi? And he says nahi. And of course leaves her at the altar because he has a wife. And you only live once and you only love once. So the entire world's sympathy, of course, went for the little girl who was left at the altar. But the dangerous message of that film was that liberated women are mad. Because the first Kangana was liberated, she came out in a towel when she had guests at home. I don't come out in a towel when I'm home alone. Why would you? She lived in a city like Kanpur and went on bikes wearing sleeveless. I don't go sleeveless to old city. See, as women in India, you have learned to engage. You have learned to navigate your way in society, right? You know, ke masjid ja rahe burkha pehnlo, disco ja rahe jeans pehnlo, shaadi ko ja rahe saadi pehnlo. You know what your parameters are, and you beautifully and gloriously live within those parameters. But to make the first Kangana so wild and so crack, the subversive message you're taking away from the modern woman is, if you're liberated, if you have the balls to stand up and say, I will marry him, I will divorce him, I will go on bikes, you are crack. That is the most dangerous message you can give. So be aware. Please watch cinema. We capture the imagination of millions of people for some reason, having made some really bad cinema. But anyways, but please be aware that it's okay to enjoy this, but you can't take this away. At some point, you have to resist this. You know, and when you are aware, I have to give you the side effects. It can turn into paranoia very soon because everything you're watching, the magnifying glass saying, "Acha, to tum mere ko ye bol rahe." I mean, that is a side effect. But rather paranoid than be regressive, no? So that is one thing.
Was it made by a man? Tanu Vets Manu?
Most films are made by men. But that's not the point. That's really not the point. Women went to watch it and filled their coffers to 132 crores. Only nation, not international yet. And another thing that, you know, Dilip Kumar told me many years ago, and here I'm dropping names because I'm in the industry and I get to meet stalwarts like that, is very, very gently in his soft Urdu, he told me, beta, na bolna seekh lo, par aapki zindagi badal jayengi. You know, at that time it didn't sound deep, it didn't sound like, ab Dilip saab kuch bol rahe hain, to kuch vazan bol lo bhai aap, ab, you know, I need to go and tell people, Dilip Kumar mere ko kya bole. And he said, was learn to say no. Really try thinking about that. How many times in our life do we say no? It always is, she'll feel bad. He asked me, kitni mohabbat se pooch raha hai. We say yes. Swear, try to learn to say no. It is very difficult, but really very necessary. So I think if we are aware and learn to say no, I guess we are home safe.
That's great advice. I think we are just about near the interval of the movie. But no popcorn and loo breaks, okay? So you are a qualified lawyer and an entrepreneur and later moved into movies. When did you have the big aha moment where you realized that this is what I'm born to do?
See, my first aha moment was when I read Jennifer Parker and Sidney Sheldon. So I became lawyer. Second aha moment was when I met Abu Jani Sandeep Khosla. And I was like, damn it, this is what I need to do. Designing is in my pore, in my blood. I need to dress up women. Second aha moment. Third aha moment, when I met Nagesh and he cast me in Hyderabad Blues, I went for a rehearsal. And I was like, you know what? This is it. I want to make movies for the rest of my life and I hope I don't have to do anything else. I've managed that for 15 years, which is the longest time. So I'm hoping that movies is it. But aha moments aate rehte, you know. You just have to, not, no pun intended, go with the flow. You know, ahas changed, ahas become with different exclamations, they become questions, they become that. But there have been different aha moments. I've taken each one of them. I was lucky, some are not, but that's okay. You know, I've learned that in movie making is because I'm an indie filmmaker, we constantly have to ask people for money. Is you see money, you dive, they say no, dust your clothes, go to the next money person. So, you know, there are falling downs and getting ups, but that's all a part of life, I guess.
Thank you. So the interval is done and the dreaded...
climax?
No. We have, what follows is always a Vico Vajradanti ad and the dreaded, the lung cancer ad, which we need to see anyway. But that's done and over with, so. Okay, what are your unique attributes that make for a great producer and an entrepreneur? Your own personal attributes.
I don't know whether they're unique or not, but you know, the kind of work that I do, it involves being with a lot of people. And I like people. I can engage with people. I like them. I like to talk to them. I like to hear them talk to me. I like to hear myself talk to them. So it is that you need to be with people. And I'm a bit of a nurturer, you know, and I think that comes with being Hyderabadi. You want to get people home, feed them, look after them, and then whip them into doing what you want them to do. So that happens. So I think the fact that I slid easily into the role of a producer was that I could engage with that many people at the same time at different levels. So, you know, as a producer, not only do you deal with stars and contracts and studio heads, but you also have to cut deals with the light men and your crew. And they are the most important, trust me. If the star doesn't come one day, we can manage with another actor. But if the light unit decides not to come, you're more or less screwed. So different people need different kind of handling. And I think I've done that well. So.
Nurturing is a great, great quality to have.
Thank you.
Can you share one anecdote from one of your film sets or shoots? We need a bit of humor quotient in the movie. So are you able to hear me at the back? Okay. Okay, I'm going to repeat this question once again. Can you share an anecdote from one of your film sets or shoots?
There are several, but I suppose keeping in thing with Women's Day. So Hyderabad Blues, I slipped in as an actress and then I became an AD. It was just an organic process, they called it. You know, when I got Hyderabad Blues, Nagesh took me as an actress. But when we were doing rehearsals, I was busy telling them, my co-actor, what to do. I was like, you do it this way, then I'll do it this way. So I think Nagesh saw that and he asked me to be his assistant director. And I had no clue what that meant. That was the first, I had never been on a film set before that. And like I keep saying, he was desperate and I was clueless, so I said yes. It was enormous amount of hard work, but it was great fun. So I got into the movies completely by accident. And I loved every bit of it. But when Rockford came along, that was our second film, we were clear in what our roles were. I would produce and I would be the producer and Nagesh would be the director. And that's how we set out in this world, because we were very clear what we wanted and we thought everybody else would be clear as what we were talking about. And so we were shooting, and every time we would shoot, Nagesh would be in front of his monitor. Nagesh is my director I work with, in case anyone is wondering, I'm taking names. So Nagesh would be, you know, looking at a scene, and suddenly people would come and ask him questions, and he would be confused, and he would say, no, check with ma'am. And I would be confused why they're going to him. I'm the producer, he's the director. So these are my areas of responsibility. But please remember, I look the way I look, I'm a woman, and I don't speak Telugu very fluently, and I was working in Hyderabad, in the movie industry. Wow. So then, you know, and this happened all through the film, and we tried to tell them that, listen, there are two different people who handle two different things. It didn't quite cut it. So we actually devised a method, well, with Bollywood Calling, our third film, until I think Iqbal, which was our sixth film, I would hire an AD, he or she, with the only purpose to fire them on day 5 or 6. So I would tell them, okay, I'm going to hire you, but your job is for 5 or 6 days. On day 6, I will publicly yell at you on set and say, out, and I will not see your face again on set. So they would say, okay. So I would publicly at day 6, at an opportune time, after winking to the poor person I was going to really zaleel karo and, you know, embarrass in front of that whole crew, yell and throw them out. And they never came back on set. So then people on set knew that I do wear the pants and I have the ability to fire. So that kind of got me a little more serious views, and people stopped going to Nagesh and they would come to me with their problems. So that is what we had to do.
And I think you also got a bit of acting practice out of the way. Okay, we get noticed for our successes, but most often it's on the back of failures that we create them. Is there any one failure of yours which you're able to convert into a stepping stone for success?
You know, my life does sound rosy right now, right? You know, I don't know, and I don't remember, or there was, I don't want to say there was no such great failure, I'm sure there was, but there was a line in Rockford that says, don't recognize failure, then there is no failing. So I don't think I recognized any such event that was so huge as a failing. There were setbacks, there were things that didn't go according to plan, there were stuff that you know, went to plan B and, you know, like I said, circumvented it. But no, I don't think, I can't remember a failure out of which a huge success came. I can't.
That's acceptable.
Oh yes, it's acceptable.
Can you tell us about the kind of movies you make and the one moment which you'll cherish in your filmmaking journey?
Okay, so this is going to be a bit long. I hope I can hold your attention. So the movies that I make, and I'm saying Nagesh and I are partners. He directs, I produce, like I just told you. The genres are very different. We've always had different genres. We started with a comedy or coming of, and went into coming of age and, you know, a satire and stuff. So that's the kind of films that we make as, you know, the genres. But we are the indie filmmakers. We don't normally have studio backing, and we don't normally have big actors or stars in our film. But there is a lot of, as they say, slice of life. People can relate to our films, they're very relatable. So in Hyderabad Blues, everybody had a mother like that who was, I just heard earlier in the day, and I won't out that person, who was sending pictures to their sons to get married. So they had, so you know, everyone in Hyderabad Blues related to mothers like that. Everyone in Hyderabad Blues related to grandmothers of coming back from the US and having mothers feed them. And all of our films do have a little bit of, oh, I know someone like that, or I was like that. So that kind of thing. But later on, as we realized that films do make such a huge impact on people, we started getting more responsible as filmmakers. So the two things I know that Nagesh and I very, 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 very consciously follow is holding on to the secular thread and fabric of our nation. So we really normalize secularism in day-to-day Indian life. And when I say this, I probably, if you've, you know, spoken to me earlier or something, you'd have heard me say this, is one of our most popular films has been a film called Iqbal, But nobody remembers Iqbal as a Muslim boy. People remember Iqbal as the deaf-mute boy who made it into the Indian cricket team. Every time Iqbal came on screen, there was no Allahu Akbar going on in the background. Iqbal didn't say adab chacha jaan or have a black mark. So there was no standoutness. All the people around him weren't Muslim, because that's bizarre. Where in India do you have Muslim people living in Muslim societies, working with Muslim people, making Muslim things? No, not in my India. I don't know which India Muslim socials talk about, where everyone is speaking chaste Urdu and Iqbal didn't speak, but that's a good thing. So, you know, that. And then we made another film called Door, which was also very, very popular. And Door, everyone remembers as the woman who went in search of another woman to save her husband's life. Nobody says Zinat, the Muslim woman who went in search of the Hindu woman. And we broke all stereotypes, because Zinat, who was the Muslim, did not wear a ghungat. She did not wear a hijab. She traveled alone in a lorry across the breadth of the country to meet a Hindu young widow who was in a veil, who was not allowed to go out. But nobody remembers that, because if you normalize it, if you don't make it like, you know, now Zinat is coming out, or, you know, and violence going on as Meera is being put in a widow garb, we don't care. We really don't care. We don't care about what your religion, your societal, constraints are, as long as an entertaining story. And that, I think, has been my biggest victory, is we have normalized secularism. Because when, like, for example, when I, to, you know, drive this point home more, is when a man is playing a woman, right, in a movie, he'll walk like this. Which one of us walks like that, yeah? Where do we walk like that, really? And if a woman is playing a man, she's constantly doing this and this. Yeah. I have not known any man to slap his thigh every 2 minutes. I swear I would leave the room. So, you know, when you're overcompensating for something that you're not, is when you're not being secular. So when you're overcompensating and saying, look how secular I am, I have a token Muslim in the film who's always a good guy. Means all Muslims in India are good people. No, I know some very evil ones, but anyways. So that's what we don't do. We normalize secularism in our films, so it doesn't stand out blatantly. So that is the kind of movies that I make. Thank you. And I am very proud about the cinema I make, really. And one of the most cherishing moments is when we won the Berlinale, which is the Berlin International Film Festival, which is exceptionally prestigious, last year with our film Dhanak. Dhanak was the only entrant from India, and that had not happened for the last 15 years. Every year there were two or three films, but in 2015, only Dhanak was selected, and Dhanak won the Grand Prix, the Grand Jury Award. And I swear, I went on stage and all my composure was lost, all this, you know, woman of substance, I was just bawling like one child. I didn't know what to do. I was just standing in the mic and saying, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's all I did. Very embarrassing, but oh, that was fantastic.
Okay, I'm going to cut short my questions, but there's some questions which just come in from the audience. I'll read out the name. You can probably stand and...
But why don't they ask me themselves? They won't be able to...
There's some questions for Nina also. So I'll read out their name. This is Rashmi Doshi. You had a question? Yeah. You had a question for Nina. Someone get her a mic, please.
Well, I guess first, before we get into this, I have to say, Ilahe, you are a breath of fresh air. I think we all felt that in the room. Thank you so much for sharing your story and journey. It was truly revitalizing.
Yeah, hi everybody, I'm Rashmi, and it's been a privilege to be invited as a guest here today. And my question for Nina is, what would be your advice to all of us women here, you know, your advice for that little one change we all can apply today on Women's Day in our lives, that, you know, that can bring about women empowerment for not only us, all the women that surround us in our lives. That little change in our attitude, what would be your advice?
Absolutely. I think there's a few things that I really try to message constantly. And the first is women helping women. I've certainly been in situations where I have seen this mentality of women, and this really pertains more to the U.S. because that's the majority of the group that I've worked with, is that corporate women in the U.S. have this, not all of them, but some of them, have this mentality of, I worked really hard to get to where I am, you should do that too. And there's this sort of stigma that surrounds them of, well, and this mentality of, well, I worked really hard by myself. And it's our job as women, I mean, we often face very similar issues, to uplift one another and help one another throughout those times and troubles, because we need each other to lean on. But it's also changing the conversation to, it's not just about women. It's also about men. I mean, this is not a women's issue in terms of equal opportunity. It's a human issue. And no matter what, people are people are people. And so definitely engaging our young boys and girls to send that message. And last but not least, I'll share a story about a particular issue in terms of self-esteem, and a message that really means a lot to me, is this idea and notion of what beauty is. And especially sitting in the seat that I sit in, I see so many beauty standards that are just unrealistic and not ideal. And particularly within India, this idea of skin color. And that's something that I grew up seeing both sides of, and very conflicting different ideas of what beauty was. I remember, you know, growing up in an Indian family in America, I was told to not go out in the sun, you know, you're gonna get so dark. And that's something that is very deeply embedded in our culture. Like I said, I grew up coming back to India every summer holidays from the time I was young. And I think I was about 10 years old, I was in fifth grade, and I had a patch of dry skin on my face. And it was nothing serious, but we went to the dermatologist, and I remember he took a look at it, and he gave me this cream, and he said, apply it 2 times a day. And I said, okay. And then I remember looking at him dead in the eye, and I said, do you think you can give me a cream to make me lighter? And bless this dermatologist's heart, he said, why? Black is beautiful. And I remember thinking, yeah, right. And walking out of there just so disappointed. And that idea of what that was is that, as I was 10 years old and I lacked the self-esteem of thinking that I wasn't worthy. And how many young girls are we sending that message to here? How many of them are going through that feeling and thinking, I'm not worthy, I'm not beautiful, I can't get this job, or I don't have the same advantage as this other girl sitting next to me? And then on the flip side, right, growing up in America, you know, all my peers and teachers would say, oh my goodness, you're so tan, I'm so pasty, I don't want to be white. And so what it really boils down to is wanting what we don't have. And we need to change that conversation and start sending positive messages with media and all the images that we see, but also that one-on-one contact, whether you're a mother, a sister, someone in the public spotlight, whatever you can do to give that sense of self-worth to not only women but girls as well, because obviously this is an issue that obviously boys deal with in society. So I think that support, we need to constantly message them from a young age. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. The next question is from Sarala Bhutaria. Bhutaria, sorry.
This is for Elahi. I just would like to know who your role model is.
They've changed, you know. I'm a little fickle.
Right now,
you know, I don't know. I mean, like I said, at different times, different people have influenced me not to completely be that, but depends on what you're doing. And then right now, yeah, it's vacant. A vacancy, anyone can step in, apply, please. I'm open, yeah, open position. Except there's no payment. I can talk about you in the next session, that's all.
That's a very original answer. The next question is from Sangeeta Verma. Sangeeta Verma, yeah, has a question for Elahi.
Not yet. You can just ask me.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, I can hear you.
As a producer, what do you think, like, which of the Indian movies we have,
which of them actually project women well? Your comment on Tanu Ved's Manu was there, but I would like to know, you must have seen films from various industries.
Yes.
Perhaps Telugu, Malayalam.
Absolutely. So there is no. Films across India don't project women well. There are the odd ones out that will come out where, you know, they'll be, but again, they will be the hero. So you'll have a Neeraja that will say, you know, watch this hero. I have no problem with the word hero. You do something heroic, you become the hero. But then there's the same ad, strangely enough, now that I remember, was an ad of Snickers in which Sonam herself is the actress doing the Snickers ad, in which they're pushing a car and then she says, oh no, I can't push this car, and they say, so kitni heroine ho jata hai. So heroine is a bad word because then you become a diva, but hero is a good word. So to answer your question, nobody depicts women the way they should be depicted. They're always objectified. And then the counter you get from people is, but they are beautiful. So of course I want to see them half naked dancing. So, you know, you get that idiotic comment back again. But no, to it's quite dismal the way they project women as on screen. I don't know about the off screen part. Of course, there is a lot of, you know, the stuff that has gone on. But on screen, there's no such thing like Malayali cinema is what you should watch if you want to see a good depiction of women. No, across the board, they don't do justice to women characters. But that's even in Hollywood. I'm not just saying that films as such is male dominated to an event, to an extent of their thinking. It's not just, you know, who looks good and who commands what fanhood. It's how they think, and it's a universal problem.
The next question comes from Kavita Rathod. This is for Nina. Kavita? Yeah.
I'm Kavita Rathod, and I have a question for Nina. Nina, we are very happy to have you here, because since you are from Vijayawada and very much a Telugu girl, so welcome.
Thank you.
And my question to you is, supposing you were offered a role by Ilahi, so if Ilahi offers a role to you, which kind of role would you demand from her?
Well, I wouldn't demand. I would think it would be a partnership, especially since she's so brilliant. And I thank you for that question, because what I found, I mean, just going off of this, is the number one question I felt like I was constantly asked is, so when are you going into Bollywood? It wasn't even, are you interested? Is that what you want? It was assumed. Yes. And that was so extremely frustrating from my end, because that's never what I wanted. And I think people were shocked when I would say that answer, because exactly. I think here what I found was that was just kind of the perception of what a beauty queen was. And I will never define myself as a beauty queen, but I certainly kind of see the misconception associated with it. And so for me, I remember when I came last year I did a media tour in Mumbai, in Hyderabad and Vijayawada. I was actually here with ZTV for Dance India Dance, and they had asked me to be a judge for their show, and I thought that was a nice little thing I was able to do, to be on the other side of the table for once. And it was a good kind of introduction to India and everything. It was right after my year. I'd finished my year of service, and I wasn't allowed to travel internationally when you're wearing the crown. And so when I came, I remember going back, and I was speaking with my manager, and I said, I just don't know if there's a voice for me here. Because the reality of this situation, and why I love Ilahi so much, we just met today and she's already amazing, is that if you're not in Bollywood or Tollywood or whatever, it's very difficult to, as a woman, to find a voice here. And that was very, very frustrating for me, because how am I supposed to reach the masses in these rural communities and spark change when I don't have a voice or feel like I even have a place, even though I connect with India on so many levels and feel like this is my home? And so that's kind of where this, you know, kind of partnership and strategic partnership of working with the right groups and people. And so the work that obviously Eli has done in terms of really that there was no idea, there was no place for empowering roles for women, not only in Bollywood, but Hollywood too. I mean, that's a huge topic of conversation right now, is why aren't there roles for strong women and portraying them in, you know, our media is so sensationalized. And so that's an interesting point that you bring up, because I mean, I have to say, I haven't seen any of your movies, but I'm so inspired to see them, because I think the most important thing is that what you take away from it, like you said, that personal emotion, that connection, and that's the message that we should really be sending.
Thank you,
Nina.
I would love to cast it, so if you do change your mind, please let me know, Nina.
We'll work on something.
Okay.
Next question also is for Nina. It's from Samruddhi.
Hi, I'm Samruddhi, and I want to ask you, my mom is really adamant on sending me in one of the pageants for Miss India. And personally, it's not something I really want to do, but my mom says it's a really good platform for me as a makeup artist in the future. So I want to know what was the grooming and, you know, the behind the scenes actions, what you were able to learn.
I can honestly say that I can't speak on behalf of Miss India because I have never experienced it, and I only hear what I hear from the outside. So that being said, I would have to say that oftentimes we're faced with a lot of decisions, not only in, you know, kind of in life, in your career, school, whatever that might be. And it's important to have an inner circle of your family, your friends, of people that you trust. But ultimately, you have to do what's best for you. And only you can make that decision. And we often, I think all of us, have a gut instinct or reaction of, is this the right path? And you have this feeling, and you have to trust your own judgment. And so for me, in terms of the industry, I genuinely don't know. Perhaps I would recommend maybe talking to someone who was involved with it and see what their experiences were. But it's your decision, and if you're wavering, trust your judgment.
Thank you.
This question is for Ilahi. Can you tell us about the challenges you had in setting up a much needed, you know, cultural hub like Lamakan? That's my question.
Topic of my life right now. So 6 years back, we set up, I have a very dear friend called Farhan, who's like my Mubola Bhai. And I mean, really, my parents introduce each other as my son and my daughter kind of thing. And he is like a brother to me. And his uncle was a very, very renowned photographer in Hyderabad. And he was a bachelor. And he cooked really well, so his home was where everybody met and had a great time. And Mamu found out that he was dying of cancer. So he called Farhan and me, and he gave us his home. And he said, this house in Banjara Hills is yours. And do live here if you want, do what you want with it, but don't make money off of it. Give it back to society. So it took us about close to a couple of years to form this trust, and we started this amazing, and I say amazing because I had nothing to do with it other than the setting it up, this place called Lamakan. Lamakan is not La Maison in French or something. It's not being clever with two languages, but it's a Persian word that means without boundaries. And we inherited the name. It was Mamu's name, was called Lamakan. And Lamakan is an open cultural space where we don't charge the performers to perform. We don't charge the audience to watch. It only runs on donation, and it is, you know, I'm actually called Hyderabad ki Jhadu. I'm supposed to know everybody in Hyderabad, and I really thought I did until Lamakan started. And it's packed with people, and I don't know any one of them. And I'm like, who are these people? Where were they? So it is a vibrant space. The difficulty in doing Lamakan was we didn't know how it would run because it was not commercial. We had taken an oath not to go public with it in newspapers and not to make it a place to be seen at, because then everyone's like, Lamakan gaye, jayenge, you know, but then it remains that much. But it had to have a life of its own, right? And that's what Lamakan became. We kept saying, this is your home, do what you will with it. And please, if you have ever any time, come to Lamakan. So we actually, you know, we don't even do the programming. Farhan Humaira and I, his wife Humaira and I, we are just the trustees, and we look after Lamakan. We beg for money, that's what we do. Other than that, we do nothing. People write in their events, curators pick up the events, curators program it. The only time we do the programming is the anniversary week, which is 10th to 20th of March. And that's our programming. We are very, you know, passionate about that week. But the downside was that we didn't know how to get it out to people. We didn't know whether the right kind of people would come. And And as you can see, I'm very, very passionate about Lama Khan. It is, you know, it's life-changing. That place is stunning. Because, you know, people say, are you starting a Prithvi? Is that a Rangasharada? And we keep saying, no, this is our homes. Our living rooms used to be like that. Mehfils used to be there. Chai used to be on the chula. Paan used to come. Samosas were served. People who came into town always stayed at home. They performed at home. So we had the Khawals coming and performing, storytelling sessions. You know, we as students went to Alliance Française, you know, the Goethe Zentrum Center, and we always thought of changing the world, and we thought we could do it. Today, our children go to Cafe Coffee Day, eat muffins, watch Bollywood songs, but we have taken those spaces away from them. Tell me one space that you have, an open space, and say, come, stay as long as you want. You don't have to order anything. You don't have to do. Come to Lama Khan. You'll find people strumming guitars, just downloading movies because we have high-speed internet free over there. They drink the chai. We give an entire meal under 100 rupees over there. And the meal consists of khichdi, khima, khatti dal, shamis, you know, freshly made eggs, all under 100 rupees. So that was a challenge to keep with the rising prices of meat, of course. And that is it, the chat. And 2 months back, we got a notice from the government to close down Lama Khan because neighbors complained that we were making a traffic problem. We do. But where is there no traffic problem? We come to my lane. We have the Sarvi restaurant and Reliance Fresh, and it's a headache to live in that lane. So there are going to be problems. So we said, hey, this is a cultural center. We are, you know, exchanging cultures. It's a vibrant space. And the lady who complained, who we call Yellamma because she keeps yelling. So this lady had complained to the authorities, and in her complaint, which they showed to me when I went to the GHMC, was what culture are they talking about? I saw a woman take a cigarette out of her mouth and put it into another woman's mouth. And that was a complaint, that we are not cultural enough, I think, because many more people were not smoking. But anyways, so we got a notice and we said, okay, so I told Farhan, the drama queen that I am, let them shut it down. Then we can challenge them and engage with them and get what we actually want, because they give us a, you know, little hard time for licenses and stuff. So then we'll do this. Before we could, it was like they served the notice at night. Next morning, there were 4,000 people signing petitions, walking to GHMC, calling for protest. We had to call all them saying, calm down, I want it shut. Don't, you know, jump the gun. But when they shut it, when they opened it, I have no clue. People, and that was my victory, that people owned the space. Last week, no, 2 weeks back, we had an epidemic of chickenpox in Lama Khan. So we shut it down and we said we can't. The entire staff is Lama Khan. So I got one email from a Lama Khan regular having booked 7 beds in the local hospital where he was going to send my staff and open Lama Khan. So Lama Khan ran on chai and samosas by the people who come to Lama Khan.